You're listening to a Weeby Geeks Network podcast.
Another world, another time, in the age of wonder.
There was once a dream. You could only whisper it. Anything more than a whisper, and it would vanish.
A battle between good and evil.
You don't know the power of the dark side.
Where shall I find a new adversary so close to my own level?
Try the local sewer.
You know of the rebellion against the Empire?
The Avengers, Earth's Mightiest Heroes.
Peace means having a bigger stick than the other guy.
One of these days, I'm gonna have a stick of my own.
I'm Groot.
Welcome to the Neverland Podcast. The podcast for lovers of Disney, Pixar, Marvel, and Star Wars.
I'm glad you're here to tell us these things.
Please welcome your host, Jeremy.
I thought he'd be taller.
Yeah, I can fly.
All it takes is faith. Trust.
Well, if it isn't the Star Spangled Man with a plan, what is your plan today?
Up to Neverland!
Take your pixie out of your pockets, Neverlanders. Sprinkle some pixie dust around, grab your happiest thoughts, and follow me to Neverland. Well, who am I? Well, you should know me by now. Haven't you been listening? It's me, Jeremy, the Spider Pan, and I'm about to lead the way into Neverland, where we're going to have, of course, a lot of fun because we have two, count them, two movie trailers and one television trailer to be able to talk about, as well as some fun Disney news with a little bit of Oscar results. Then, because there's a Power Ranger movie just around the corner, I thought it would be fun to dig up some audio I've been sitting on from a comic convention here from Kansas City for a very long time, where I was delighted, actually, with Austin St. John. Now, I've said many times I was not a fan of the Power Rangers, but, you know, I figured this guy was the Red Rangers, and for a while, Disney did own Saban, and you could find the Power Rangers actually in a Disney park. So I figured I would go and record it, and I really enjoyed his talk. I will warn you before we get to the audio that at whatever point, they're kind of near the beginning, he decided he would sit down his microphone and just talk plainly to the room. I have done my best to try to make that audio as hearable and understandable as possible. You may have to turn up the volume a little bit on whatever you're listening on, but it's some great audio. Either way, we're going to have a lot of fun today, so we might as well just get straight to it.
Spanning the Disney and geek universe to bring you the best in comics, toys, movies, and entertainment. This is news from around Neverland.
How many of you college students were fans of Doc McStuffins? You're probably young enough, you probably were watching that. As for me, I'm a little old, I've never watched an episode of Doc McStuffins. But this is pretty cool. Over in Orlando, in the Disney's Animal Kingdom Park, you can now meet Doc McStuffins. She is over by the Rafiki Planet Watch in Disney's Animal Kingdom. There's a bit of a greeting. And there's children very, very thrilled that this has now happened. And if you happen to have some young children yourself and are planning a trip, go there. It'll be a great photo opportunity. And there's even a story on the Disney Parks blog of a three-year-old who was so excited that just squealed, which that's part of the enjoyment of going to Disney is if you have children, having them be very excited for meeting the characters and stuff like that. And you know what? As a grown adult, we can still have fun and meet and greet these characters. So if you happen to be a fan of Doc McStuffins and you're in your 20s, who cares? Go in and go hug the character. Go get a photo. Have fun and enjoy. Just don't push a little kid out of the way when you do it, right? So this past Sunday was the Academy Awards, also known as the Oscars. And we definitely had some Disney representation going on. And I am rather proud to say that I did really enjoy the fact that Piper, the little Pixar short, has won for Best Animated Short. I really enjoyed it. It was really, really creative, clever, very even believable. It was almost photorealistic. I really enjoyed it. I'm happy to see that it won. Disney also took honors for The Jungle Book for Best Visual Effects. Now, I did see some people surprised that Rogue One did not win that one, but when you consider The Jungle Book, considering it's probably more of an animated film than it is really a live-action film, this really only had one live actor. The entire jungle environment, all of the animal characters were all generated in a computer. And that does qualify as some pretty impressive visual effects, so I'm very happy to say the Jungle Book did win for visual effects, even though you could almost consider it a criticism that it's, I don't know why they call it live action, it's an animated movie with one live actor, and there's even people saying such things about rumors that I'm hearing about a Lion King film that could be made, and they're calling it a live action. But it's going to basically be animated because you will not probably see a single human in that entire film when it gets made. You know, so, yeah, granted, you could call it an animated film. But there's a difference, I think, though, between creating an animated character that looks like an animated character and creating one that is meant to look like the real thing. And in the Jungle Book, we did see, granted, they're animated, but the animals in there were very realistic looking. They did not look like a typical cartoon-style animated character. So it was very, very impressive. So I did enjoy that, and I was glad for them to win. Also, big winner was Zootopia for Best Animated Feature. And this is one of the ones I think got chosen because of its social justice messaging that was going on, which I felt was a little heavy-handed and a bit preachy. And it actually took away from my enjoyment of the film, although I did like the film. And I was really enjoying the innovation of a city where they did consider the type of environment that all of these animals lived in. I would criticize, though, that this should have been called Mammaltopia because it was all mammals and we didn't see any birds or reptiles or anything. And if they continue on and make, a sequel to Zootopia, I would really like to see some other animals represented in the story to just kind of expand it and make it more like an actual Zootopia. Very much congratulations to everybody who worked on that one. Personally, I was pushing for Kubo and the Two Strings to win for Best Animated Feature because that film completely blew my mind. It was amazing visually to look at with what they did with the puppetry, even having the now largest stop-motion puppet ever built with this giant skeleton. If you have not seen this film, I highly recommend it. The story is wonderful. It's kind of a surprise how it goes towards the end, and it really enforces the value of family and good storytelling. It's a wonderful movie, and I was really surprised that it didn't win, but I kind of predicted it. I was talking to my wife actually yesterday. It's like, well, Zootopia is going to win because Hollywood loves to, you know, have social justice values in a film, and anything that furthers those, they're going to, of course, you know, be very excited about, and they definitely were. And it is a good movie, and it is deserving. So congratulations to Zootopia, but I still liked Kubo better. Now, this is very, very cool. Of course, this mainly is a benefit to anyone who is 14 and under. But this is really neat. Out at Walt Disney World in the Disney Springs, this is what used to be known as Downtown Disney, they have a new, sort of a Disney photo pass service. And Disney photo pass service is generally where you can get professional photos taken of your trip to Walt Disney World. But this is really cool. And this is, you know, you've seen probably commercials where they have, you know, storybooks that you can have your child's name in or something like that. And, you know, if you happen to be a UCM college student, you probably don't have, you might have children, but you might not, you know, if you're a traditional student. Non-traditional students, we probably have some children. But this is a little book now that's personalized for your child, but they actually are going to take photos of your child as whatever character in these little storybooks and put your child into the book with a little bit of Disney magic and a little photo processing. And there are some photos here. There's a little girl who is now playing the role of Anna in Frozen in a little book. I also see a picture here where we have a little girl. Looks like she is Elena of Avalor, I believe, because she's holding a little wand here. But so you get these different storybooks, and then you get to be replaced in the book. Photos of your child if you're under 14. You can be in it yourself. Now, I would love if they have like a Star Wars available if I were under 14. I'd love to have myself put into a Star Wars book or something like that. That would be a lot of fun. But this is a very cool feature that you can do now at Disney Springs. I'm pretty sure this, if not already, it will be available over in Disneyland. They do have a downtown Disney area, actually in between parks, between Disney's California Adventure and Disneyland Park. I do expect that this will be available there. This is probably going to be a very expensive endeavor, but oh my goodness, the memories you can make with this are just, it's worth the cost, I would think, right?
Mama, another gator got in the house.
Another gator? Give me that shovel. Come here.
Get him, Mama. Get that gator.
The Neverland Trailer Park.
Destination, McDuck Manor.
McDuck Manor? As in Scrooge McDuck? The bajillionaire?
You're finally gonna sell us.
Do it. Make Scrooge McDuck.
Are you you really our uncle? How old are you?
You used to be a big deal. Whatever happened to you?
Used to be a big deal. I'm Scrooge McDuck. I made my name being tougher than the toughies and smarter than the smarties.
Sure, you want to do it the easy way.
Oh my gosh, the nephews! What are your blood types? What's Donald really like? Who's the evil triplet?
Louie. Eh. We're just a normal, boring family.
Normal? Boring? Ha! Donald Duck is one of the most daring adventurers of all time!
Oh well. Run a multi-trillion dollar business. I can handle a few juveniles for the weekend. Besides, we've got a pretty low-key day planned. I'm back! Uncharted territory! Bold new discoveries!
You guys, our family is awesome!
Aw, family truly is the greatest adventure of all on the ground!
DuckTales, woo!
DuckTales, woo! We finally got a good look now at the upcoming animated series coming to Disney XD. And yes, it looks kind of different. You know, this is a more modern style where it's that simplicity that you see often in current animation. And, you know, I've had people comment that it come almost square-shaped size of Huey, Louie, and Dewey's heads. They seem more rectangular with curved edges, but it looks pretty good, and they're trying to base this more off some of the original Carl Barks designs. It looks like it's going to be a whole lot of fun. I am still, you know, pretty much excited for this thing, and I'm really liking their voice for Scrooge McDuck. He does sound great, and there was nothing about this that I didn't like, other than the modern simplistic type of animation. It seems a little lazy to me. I loved the animation of the original. I mean, Disney Television animation, I think, used to. I don't know, it had more style to it. Like, not that it doesn't have style now, but I mean, you know, I really liked the look of things. Everything had more something, you know, so, back in the day. And maybe it's just the nostalgia. But I don't know that it looks, as far as design-wise, as good as, like, the 87 and that style and everything. But, you know, as far as a series goes and the fun level, the humor is definitely working for me. Especially, I love the bit at the end with Launchpad. Oh, family. Oh, look, the ground, as he's nearly crashing the plane. And a lot more fun with Donald. I hope Donald is going to be a mainstay in this series, because I'm a huge fan of Donald Duck. I love Donald Duck. And we do get to see him doing some different things, but it also does seem like he drops the nephews off with an Uncle Scrooge there at the beginning. And so maybe we're going to go from that angle, kind of like the original DuckTales series, but I'm still hoping that Donald Duck will play a major role in the series. And overall, I'm excited for this. This looks like it's going to be a whole lot of fun.
Hope you're ready. It'll be here any minute. Is that a rifle?
You don't know what a rifle looks like?
It's just swords were your thing and guns were mine. But I guess we're both doing guns now. I just didn't know that.
Well, that's intense.
I see it within you. Fear. Jealousy. Betrayal. It is our duty to cleanse the universe of this weakness.
You know, they told me you people were conceited douchebags, but that isn't true at all.
Dude.
I'm using my wrong eye.
Groot, put your seatbelt on! So we're saving the galaxy again?
Yep.
Awesome! We're really going to be able to jack up our price if we're two-time galaxy savers.
Yes!
Sometimes the thing you're searching for your whole life
It's right there by your side all along.
You're right.
All you do is yell at each other. You're not friends.
No, we're family. Except maybe her.
After all these years, I've found you.
And who the hell are you?
I'm your dad, Peter.
So, yet another trailer and another good look at Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. I think this might be the closest we get to actually getting a little bit of plot details. Insofar as at the end, we finally got a good look at Kurt Russell. And as I have predicted, he is playing Star-Lord Peter Quill's father, which is a great choice in casting. Now, the part that is interesting is in the comic books, Peter Quill's father is sort of an evil king, sort of a... Well, he's just a bad guy. We'll put it like that. And he's kind of an enemy for the Guardians of the Galaxy. And usually when he wants something for Peter, it's usually something troublesome for him. And, you know, James Gunn said that he wanted to do something different with the father and have him be a bit more benevolent. So not exactly sure what's going on. I have read somewhere that he is supposed to be like Ergo or Ego, the living planet, which, you know, I am not well versed in Guardians of the Galaxy lore. I don't usually, when I was reading Marvel, I didn't really get into the cosmic characters, except for maybe Darkhawk. Used to love to read that, but when it started getting a bit too cosmic, I kind of started falling away. I like the street level characters back in the day when I was really reading. I haven't read a whole lot in a while, but anyway, that's beside the point. We get to see a little bit of Nebula as she's starting to join the Guardians. We see the continued family theme of them, you know, being sort of a weird family of friends that they are together. You know, we are still Groot. Get to see a little bit more of the fun. Overall, this, every time they show something new, I get more excited for this movie. That's all I can say. This looks like it's going to be immense fun, so I'm definitely excited for it still, and more excited, like I said, every time I see some new footage. So definitely gotta check this. This trailer is on YouTube. If you haven't seen it already, go watch it about 500 times, okay? And then be really prepared for the movie coming out later this year.
Pirates had infected the seas for generations. So I vowed to eliminate them all. And then, there was this boy. Jack Sparrow.
Follow him in!
He took everything from me. And filled me with... rage.
The dead have taken command of the sea. We're searching for a pearl, a girl, and a sparrow.
I have heard stories of a mighty Spanish captain who hunted and killed thousands of men.
No. Men, no. No. Pirates.
I once knew a Spaniard named something in Spanish.
He's coming for you, Jack.
Where is your ship? Your crew?
Your pants? Jack!
I'm so sorry, were you still talking?
There's nowhere to hide. Find Sparrow for me.
From this moment on, we are to be allies.
Considering where your left hand is, I'd say we're more than that.
Oh, monkey.
I'm not looking for trouble.
What a horrible way to live.
You will pay for what you did to me.
Ship are looking for Jack, so I'm going to swim for it.
Karina, stop that.
No, don't stop that.
This has gone far enough.
No, it has not.
I saw her ankles.
You'd have seen a lot more if you kept your cake holes shut.
Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Men Tell No Tales. I gotta say that every time I see something for this, it kind of looks pretty cool. It does beg a question, though, as what we do see in here is the pirate, well, he's not really a pirate, but the ghost captain of, I guess, a ship of, he was a pirate hunter, probably for the Spanish Navy, was somehow tricked by Johnny Depp, or, well, Captain Jack Sparrow, as a young boy, and they found somebody who kind of almost looked a little like Johnny Depp. It was kind of cool. But anyway, so we find a young Captain Jack Sparrow that has tricked this guy into wrecking his ship, and they have all die. For whatever reason we do not know, they are given an afterlife as some sort of ghost sailors. Why in the world did it take so long for them to be able to track down Jack Sparrow to where it's just now happening after all these years? You know, because Jack was just like looks like a teenager. And now we have, you know, Johnny Depp is what, you know, around 50? So Jack Sparrow seems to be around 50. What took so long? I have to wonder. But hopefully they will answer that question in the film. But overall, we don't know. All I know is I do like the guy who's playing the villain of this piece. He's always entertaining, and for some reason he's trying to track down this girl, and of course, Jack Sparrow. We don't know any more details. There's probably more going on than what we know. But overall, this looks like a lot of fun. This has a lot of the typical trailer tropes of the very percussive drum thing to different action shots to speed things along and trying to be in rhythm with the Hans Zimmer score there. So it's a lot of the typical things we see, but either way, it looks very, very cool, and I'm actually kind of excited to see this, and it's opening on Memorial Day, which will be right around my birthday on May 26th, which, by the way, I'm turning 40 on that day. We really should do something fun for our episode for that weekend. I'm going to have to plan something, have my own Neverland birthday party for myself, turning 40. But, yeah, so that's coming up Memorial Day, and I am actually going to be a little bit excited for that.
To Disney and beyond.
Big table, big room. It's like, or do they think we're compensating? Sure. So it's up. I'm pretty simple. So questions, how do you guys want to do?
Might have a couple questions because a couple things we want to get into. Being the original Red Ranger, being the basically kicking all off by doing the martial arts part where I got ready to were inspired by the Power Rangers and it's become their lifestyle. Do you run into that a lot and, you know?
Yeah, I left the business for 20 plus years, so I was a ghost. In fact, I know guys who still curse at me because they spent so many years trying to find me to get me back into the business. And I went to work as a medic and a firefighter, and then I did work with the government for 4 years through the Department of Defense in the Middle East, so I was a hard guy to find. So long and short, now, a little over a year ago, I got together with my agent, Zach, who's floating around here somewhere, one of the show owners for Lexington, who tracked me down via email. I'm in the Middle East, and I finally get to a place where I can get email, and I get this email from this random guy named Jared, and Jared, who's this? And he's talking about a Comic-Con. I was like, what's a Comic-Con? Who's Jared? Why did he have my email? And he, probably 12 years prior, somehow found one of the old fire departments I was working at and found my email in a mass email that had gone out to all the medics and whatnot. And I guess he just went through and tried them one at a time. And so I thought, okay, well, I'll bite. Let's see. What's a Comic-Con? And I got this full explanation. And I thought, okay, wow, that's weird. And after that, he sent me a few more emails. I didn't really talk to him because I thought maybe he was nuts. And Walter Jones, I was on the Iraqi-Kuwaiti border, and every so often, Walter was my boy. I played Zach the Black Ranger. And we still, you know, we're pretty tight. Anyway, so we were catching up. I was like, dude, I'm tired of getting blown up. I'm coming home. And he says, you're not going to believe what I'm doing. And then he says the word to me, Comic-Con. And I went, no, come on. He's like, yeah. He's like, all our fans are there, and they've grown up. And I was like, no, they didn't. Stop. Come on, they got bigger. What? And I got to agree with my agent. He's like, I can book you around the world. You'll be busy. You'll have shows every weekend. I was like, no, stop. Stop. It's like, one show. Let me do one show. Let's see what this is like. And then I'll think about global tours. You know, because it's been 20 years since somebody said global tour to me. I was having you know, visions and flashbacks, post-traumatic Hollywood syndrome. It was crazy. And I didn't know if I wanted to do that. And so I did the show in Houston, and I met you guys for the first time in 20 years. And you guys were pretty done out awesome. And I got to hear how the story impacted your lives. And I realized, you know, the show was pretty immense, 40 countries, 90 languages. You know, most of you guys were hiding behind mom's leg when you would come to see me, you know, and wouldn't talk. A few of you college kids were like, we don't watch Power Rangers. You know, because it wasn't cool to watch it then in college. Now people are like, I'm watching it on Netflix, want to come over? Bring the popcorn. So anyway, I started hearing all of the stories, and some of them were mind-blowing and heart-touching, you know. Quality family time with people that are no longer here. This was the 1 hour that abusive and dysfunctional families would all sit down and watch TV and be happy. And other extreme stories that just, I mean, give me goosebumps. So it blew me away. And next thing I know, I'm on a world tour. So we've been in Australia, the UK, Canada, all over the US. And you guys are still touching my heart, you know, hearing a lot of these stories and seeing the affection and the love and the martial arts and, you know, how many different directions each of you got from either myself or one of my castmates and what you chose to do with that direction is pretty incredible. So kudos to you guys.
Well, and now you talked about doing the EMT, which you did in Washington, D.C., and you did the stuff with the DOD, going overseas, that type of thing. Where all did you go? I thought it was just a great, like, Kuwait, Iraq, that type of thing.
Yeah, it was Kuwait, Iraq, and Afghanistan. And then when we would get some time off, which was dependent on how things were going, you know, we'd get some leave time because you get burned out pretty quick over there. We would jump into, like, Abu Dhabi or Dubai, Bahrain, some of the closer cities that probably still really sound far away from you guys. But those were places where nobody was shooting at anybody. Kuwait actually wasn't bad either. Kuwait was pretty much non-combat. Iraq and Afghanistan were not nice. Beautiful, but not nice.
So, and then all that experience that you had, which brings us to your most recent project, Survival Zen.
Oh yeah.
Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Survival Zen, how many of you guys are on Facebook or Twitter? Any of you guys on my page already? You seen it? Apparently there's a lot of people trying to be me, I guess, or they were, or yeah, I'm not sure. I know there's a lot of me when I type in Austin St. John. There used to be about 20 of them. We've got it down to maybe 3 or 4 that are out there. The easiest way to find my page is to Google Austin St. John Facebook, and you'll it'll pop up. And now, finally, it took a year to get verified. I'm like, I'm me. I keep telling you, me is me. And what a battle that was. So look for the blue check mark. I've been on social media for a little over a year now. I've got a couple 100,000 people in there. So we're building. But anyway, the point to that is Survival's End, we've put up on Facebook, on my page, as well as Survival's End Facebook page, a trailer for a movie that we're doing. And any of you familiar with it yet? Some of you maybe? Okay. We are hoping to finish filming later this year. It's a post-apocalyptic, end-of-the-world sort of thriller. And my character, the director wrote the script before he met me, and then he met me and goes, you are a medic in the Middle East? Yeah. And what's a tactical medical operator? I was like, well, that's a medic with a rifle. And a lot of really cool skills. He's like, kind of like special forces. I was like, yes and no. He's like, I have something for you, man. So he hands me this script and we start talking. I was like, yeah, that's pretty much my life right there. Minus the whole 90% of the world dies part. But anyway, so he, you know, 90% of the population dies of this horrible virus that breaks out. My character comes back from the war after inadvertently being a part of a genocide. He's forced to make a decision that, you know, kills millions. And kind of messes with him, puts a few demons up here in his locker. And he comes back and his wife and his daughter are killed. And so the horrible things happen to him, and he tries to find survivors and help keep them alive in this apocalyptic world. And you watch him struggle. And one of his things is he gets the opportunity at the end to go to this kind of Shangri-La. And I mean, you're fighting the government. Government's trying to finish people off and survivors and stuff. And so he's fighting the government, he's fighting the infected, and he's trying to keep the non-infected alive. And it's all kind of his penance because he feels like he was part of this genocide. So rather than go out to the Shangri-La, he feels like his penance is to continue to carry on, to find people and lead them and keep them alive. So it's not a gory film. There's going to be some pretty gruesome blisters. So parents, maybe teenage boys or girls would be fine. I don't know about younger than that. And it's a pretty cool flick.
Well, are you looking to self-distribute, or are you looking for a distributor, or that type of thing?
We are.
Can you guys hear me like this?
Yeah.
It feels weird.
So we're looking at self-distro or distribution.
I was talking with Steve.
I can never remember his name. Rudy.
Sam White's
really nice guy. But we've seen each other at shows all over the world. And I was just sitting there talking, yeah, we gotta get some distro. I said, did you just abbreviate distribution?
Yeah, I did.
He goes, cool. I could have been distree. Shouldn't it be distree with an I? I was like, technically. But that's not as cool. So anyway, we got the chat. We are our director. Are you guys familiar with Sundance, the film?
Yes. Sure.
Everybody knows this. So our director, his last film is called Frank vs. God. And it's a kind of a soul-searching comedy type. Who is God? Is he there? And this one man's travel and path to discover his own inner truth. And it's pretty good movie. So he got that into Sundance, and it got picked up, and it's one of eight films he now has in global distribution. So he's going to try and take the same route with this one. And we'll also have, we're going to talk to Netflix, we're going to talk to the Sci-Fi Channel. We're going to get it out there. So hopefully we will finish filming in November. And I think people are pretty pumped. I've got four other films I'm working on too, but you guys are probably here to talk about Power Rangers. I don't want to take away from that. So.
Well, I'm sure people out there have a few questions. I see some fans, so
let's see. One or two.
This is not good. Okay. Might have people come on up. So obviously you probably heard about the reboot coming up.
Yeah.
The new movie. Are you going to be involved in that at all? Cameo, anything?
You know, I was out of biz for 20 years. When I finally did the last Power Morphicon, which was ballistic, I don't think I saw the end of my line for 3 days. There was some dedicated folks. Anyway, the point was, while I was out there, a lot of my old co-workers, the directors, producers, one of the guys who was a PA, who's now the executive producer of the show, was like, wow, that's what 20 years we'll do. Anyway, so we got to chatting, and they mentioned the movie, and they mentioned the series, and we talked a little bit. And I said, I'm sorry, when you guys asked me to come back to Battle Force, I was in the Middle East, and I couldn't. Hey, sorry guys, hold on to your rifles, I gotta go shoot this movie up right now. That wouldn't have been the right answer, so I said, I wasn't, shooting you down, I just couldn't do it. So we got to talking about the upcoming series, and he mentioned Dino Charge. And they were already finished with the first portion of Dino Charge. I think they're filming the second portion, or finishing up the second portion now. And he says, well, we just brought back a lot of the originals for
Super Mega Force.
I was thinking wrestling, Super Mega Smackdown. So he had mentioned, he says, maybe after Dino Charge, we can talk. And that's kind of where we left it. I said, well, what's going on with the movie? He says, I have no idea. I'm in New Zealand doing the series. So, okay. And then I've had some discussion with Swan Entertainment, and I have no contract right now to do the movie. Neither do any of the other. That's not true. I know one that would be brought back, but they want him in an on-screen person. So they did voiceover. And you'll be quite happy about it, I can't say it. But anyway, that's the only one I know of out of the original cast, bad guys, the whole crew that has a contract. I know there's a lot of rumors and discussion about people saying they have contracts. I can be careful. I'm dying to see who they're going to bring back, or whether they're going to, you know, some young guy be passing of the torch, or is he cool? What does he look like? I've heard discussions about what's the movie? Yeah, I'm sorry, I've been out of business for 20 years, so all these movies escape me. I want to say it's Twinkle or Twilight.
Robert Pattinson.
As a movie guy, I'm having to get caught up on everything that's going on in here. My kids educate. No, Dad. Anyway, I guess the guy who played the werewolf.
Oh, Jacob Black? Taylor Lautner? Taylor Lautner?
Ish. That sounds maybe right. If he was the werewolf dude, that was like
he was Shark Boy.
Jacked.
Yeah,
so the ladies are like, oh, yeah.
He was a martial artist. He was a martial artist.
I have heard that he is being looked at for Red Ranger. No idea if it's true.
Thank you.
But apparently he's a good man. So,
looks more like Tommy to me.
I have no idea. Anyway, we'll see how it goes. I have no idea who they're looking at for anybody else. What's your question?
So technology has changed a lot since the very first Power Rangers came out. What was the set like? I mean, what type of technology was used for Zordon? And like, I mean, now it'd all be like green screens and things like that. But like.
Well, we did a lot of green screens.
Yeah.
I'll give you two words. Low budget.
No kidding.
So just picture, you know, buildings like this one. Probably in this room alone, we could build the command center over in that corner, walk across the hallway. Right here would have been the old high school, the lockers, Miss Appleby and the principal. And then this corner might have been the juice bar, you know, with Ernie and those guys. And then, I don't know, something else ran and we could tear down and build up as needed over there. So it was all just in a big warehouse. As far as the tech goes, we were shooting on film then, which is expensive. It's still expensive to shoot on film, which is why people get so irked about the budget. You see movie budgets going through the roof. You know, you got a 30-day shoot on a film like Batman, or you know, Michael Bay, you know, Transformers, and you figure $1 to $2 a foot of film all day, every day for 30 days. Thousands and thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of feet of film, and the budget goes through the roof just to make the camera look, much less the talent we want the guy behind it. So we were shooting film, which was the most expensive part of the operation. And we had green screen sections where we'd come in, and you know, the whole piece where our faces never change. To this day, when you watch Tyrannosaurus, it makes me like this. So we shot it for a pilot on green screen. And they're like, oh, that's stock footage. We don't need to go back and change that. So they never did. Budget. So we had green screen stuff, but we definitely didn't have the ability to do, you know, just running a GoPro digital. People shoot movies on their cell phones right now. And so that is what I'm doing. I've got these independent films that I'm working on, and we're doing them all digital format. And a lot of friends, a lot of favors, a lot of up-and-coming folks. I love working with the underdogs, that's why I became a medic. And we're going to put together some cool stuff, doing it all in digital format, editing on the computer. And we still won't have Michael Bay type special effects, but you know, it's still
going to be
cool. What's that?
You don't need them.
I like you. Good answer. What are you doing, lady?
I'm watching my VHS of Happy Birthday, Zach.
Yes! Walter,
yeah.
He's the man.
I have a two-part question. One is, if you were asked to come back and they let you choose a color other than red or gold, or you could choose those two, what color would you choose? And also, would you morph for us?
Would I come back? Probably. As far as what ranger would I be, I can't fathom being any other ranger.
Damn right.
And I have a blast being the gold ranger. I had all the cool effects. I drove over here. pick another superhero. Has ever got near him here? Drove along. I had Tyrannosaurus, and let me tell you, feeding him was tough. But Gold Ranger was really cool. I got to do the Sixth Ranger thing. Everybody's getting their butt kicked, and I'm like, take it, I got this. Not rolling in the house.
It was awesome.
But whether I was the gold or the red, and somebody pointed this out to me, because some of you guys were really dedicated, and they told me that my character is the only one in the history of the show that has never been defeated. And I had to think about that. I thought, is that right? And I was never defeated. I fought monsters unmorphed. You know, Goldar, I spent an entire episode in a ring with him, swinging the sword in my head. And, you know, various other entities. You know, I fought Evil Green Ranger. And after that defeat, then I invited him to the team.
Holy
cow. You know, so just some of these epic battles, and some of the most famous episodes of the show, happened while I was the Red Ranger. And I think that's kind of where my heart lies. He was humble. He was low-key. His team was always first. He was never a look-at-me kind of guy. And, you know, his team was his family. And that's how he treated it. I think that kind of resonates with who I am. So I would probably have to come back as the Red.
Yeah. And kind of also two-part. Sorry.
That's right.
Anyways, a lot of people here, you know, they grew up on the show. You were one of their childhood heroes. So, like, my first part of the question is, like, who were your childhood heroes that you watched on the screen? And how does it feel to know that you're in a similar position to them, to people today?
As far as my heroes go, my mom and dad don't like me. And, no, they weren't on TV, but mom was a cop. First female officer in Roswell, Mexico in the 70s when they didn't want a female. Unless you were a secretary, you didn't need to be in the police force. That's how they felt. And she fought hard and earned her place and did a heck of a job. So that has always been something that I loved about her and I thought was pretty heroic. My father, Mustanger in the Marine Corps, enlisted. Then he went officer candidate, finished up his college degree while raising babies. And heck of a man, officer and gentleman. As far as superheroes, you know, I mean, of course, I watch Superman, Spider-Man, Batman. You know, Batman's pretty cool. I do like his toes. So I dig a lot of those type characters. But probably in the martial arts world, because I was at it since I was 5, probably Bruce Lee. And maybe Jackie Chan. Like those are two guys. I watch them to this day, and just wow, every time I watch them, they're great. Chuck Norris has got to be in there because he had a beard. Chuck was a man. So those would probably be my TV type heroes. Did I answer all that?
How does it feel to know that you're in a similar position to them for people now?
You know. I've been a lowly old medic and firefighter for a long time. And I picked up a rifle in my pack, and I did what I needed to do overseas with every other brother and occasionally assistant, just like me. So I struggle personally with feeling any different than anybody else. I have a hard time putting myself in that place that you described. But, you know, I come from a long line of public service. That's where my heart lies, and I think if you had to ask me to describe myself, that's exactly how I would. So, I guess that's my answer. you know, they each taught me things in their own way. They each brought some really cool and special things to their characters and as individuals. Billy, David Yost, and Walter Jones, who played Zach, We travel together quite a lot. We're a lot of the same shows. I haven't seen Amy Jo, who played Kimberly, probably in 20 years, but I hear she's doing well. She's a pretty special gal. And Twee passed away, the Yellow Ring. She was like a sister. So I think that would probably be my favorite team. I don't know that I can pick one. It's a good question.
So in the show, when you first, when Rocky was first introduced and he took over as Red Ranger, there was mention that you and I can't remember who the other ranger was were like, yeah, we're gonna go off and join the Peace Corps somewhere else. Was that like a nod to, were you already like in the works of going overseas? You mentioned being admitted and going to Afghanistan, Iraq, and so on. Was that a nod into what you're going to do, or is that just a crazy happenstance?
That was, the way that you guys viewed the series when I left, I was there, everything was fine, there was no warning about me leaving, and then you saw three episodes where all you saw was the back of my head and somebody that kind of sounded like me, but probably wasn't. If you go back and watch those, Brad Hawkins was playing me. And the long and short story is I got together with the other Rangers. I said, this is a non-union show. I'll tell you what I was being paid. Say what they were being paid, but it wasn't great. I was making $611 every 2 weeks for a show that made over $1 billion in its first year. I'm still not rich. I have no desire to be rich. I mean, I wouldn't complain, but I'm not dying to do it. But I felt like I should be able to pay my bills and maybe help my family out on a show that big with that sort of income. So I went to the other Rangers and said, I've had enough. Yeah, I think at the time it was 1920. I was like, I'm going to make a stand. I'm gonna tell them things don't change, I'm gone. Who's with me? And, well, in the end, two stuck with me. And I said, well, this is the way it is. And they said, no, this is the way it is. And I said, goodbye. And they didn't think I would do it, so they filmed three episodes where you saw the back of my head, somebody's voicing me, and next thing you know, there's a casting call out for a new Red, Yellow, and Black Ranger. And, I didn't want to leave the show. I would like to have stayed. I enjoyed it, but I couldn't stand for what I thought was taking advantage of me, and I wasn't about to lay down for it. I'm a pretty hard-headed guy, and I still don't lay down. So we left. Things, conversations broke down, agreements broke down, and we carried on. So when you look at the transition of power, you talk about Rocky coming. I get people that ask me all the time, well, how did it feel when Zordon said, you know, Tommy was the leader, you were standing there? I wasn't there at all. Not even in spirit. So, you know, bring it to the action. What about all this beef stuff? You ever heard me say anything negative? Not once, nor will you. I got better things to do with my time now. So, you know, such is life. But that's kind of how it happened. I disappeared with Twee and Walt. We were out working on other projects. Shortly after that, I traveled the world. I found other martial arts places to study, and I had some hard times. Ended up living out of my Jeep for a while in a riverbed in Arizona, and I would teach martial arts during the day at a studio. I taught kickboxing at under Master Allen at Foothills Karate Studio. He taught jiu-jitsu. We traded lessons. Not Gracie style, but Machado style. I don't know those of you that follow the arts. And so we traded lessons, and I traveled all around the world and did more martial arts. And then I decided maybe I should get my education. And so I had dropped out of high school to take the job, which my father was not happy about. And so I went back, got my GED, and then I made my way through college. I got my bachelor's, I got my second degree in emergency medicine. Now I also sit on a company called, sit on the board for a company called Heartland Image Foundation. It's .org if you want to check it out. And I head up the education board there. And we just were approached by the Dean of Northwest University. And I'm hoping, we run filmmaker boot camps. How many of you younger guys, gals are at high school or grade school somewhere? Okay, so imagine if, how old are you?
10, almost 11.
Okay, so it's a good age. Imagine, have you ever written an essay? Have you done one of those yet? Okay, so we will approach school-age children through our website, and we're a 501c3 company. And we ask children, through their parents, to write an essay about a story they would like to tell. And then we bring them in, a whole group of them. We pick the best, that person becomes the director. We bring in cameras, film, and art department, and we teach them how as a unit to formulate and build their own short movie. And when they leave, they have their own products that they have produced. You know, parents a lot of times will come and watch because it's pretty cool. So we keep kids busy during the summer, parents get a little vacation. And the kids get to be a part of something really cool. And so we just finished our first filmmaker boot camp for kids. And now we're gonna take that curriculum to some universities and pass it on. And I'm hoping I'll get a PhD out of it, so we'll see. But anyways.
I have another question.
Yes, ma'am.
Stemming off of the young person who asked, but what was your favorite bad guy that you got to fight with?
Well, I spent a lot of time fighting Goldar.
Goldar was a pretty good fighter at the start.
He and I will still have work at conventions together. Usually he'll be like right across from us. And, you know, he'll spew something out in Goldar's voice. It's Carrick. I don't know how many of you guys have met him. Really cool guy. Like, yes, Ranger! Throw that out of me, and I'll be like, I took you down once, don't make me do it again. So we get banter going back and forth. So he's pretty cool. But you didn't ask me who my favorite bad girl. Because, gentlemen, how many of you noticed once or twice a very attractive evil woman on the show? And I'm not talking about Rita. Scorpina, I was waiting for Scorpina. Scorpina, and how about the movie? How about Divita?
Yes!
Scale of 1 to 10, that's yummy. Anyway, she was 3 months pregnant when she filmed that for the movie.
Awesome.
That's what we said.
What?
So, that would probably be my favorite.
You mentioned a lot of, you know, trained in a lot of martial arts. I was just curious, and this is probably on Facebook pages or websites, but how many different styles have you trained in?
I have to tell you this because people, especially one individual, they give me a hard time. You're not really a martial artist. Okay, I'm joking. Anyway, my father was a Marine, and this was back before things changed where now they won't let you move any sooner than 3 years unless you have very specific MOS. Well, back when I was a kid, that didn't exist. So my father, we moved every 9 to 12 months. My father started me in Kenpo. My mother put me in at Judo at the age of 5. So I had both arts at the age of 5. And then we would move, and it wasn't like today where there was 25 martial arts shops on every street corner. It was, I took what was available whenever I got where I went. And I would spend a year there, and I was the guy that was in there every day. Every day I could get there, I was in there for hours and hours on it. So I sucked up a lot of information from, probably by the time I was 17, I'd been through 13, maybe different arts. And no, I didn't have black belts in 13 different arts. I had my second dan in Taekwondo, my first dan in Kenpo by that age. I picked up 2 more black belts later. And then I discovered that I didn't really care whether I had a belt or what the belts were about. I began to understand the importance of passing on the knowledge. I began to understand the importance of just treating it with true humility and respect. So since then, I've traveled and been through probably a total of 17 different arts, give or take, at much varying levels of exposure. So it was mixed martial arts. I was before mixed martial arts became big in the 90s. And by big, I mean Horace Gracie broke into the market and put MMA on the map, essentially, with grappling. And you saw a grappling guy take out a strike fighter. Nobody had seen that. It was like, oh my gosh. So I had learned a lot of that stuff prior. I wasn't the greatest or the best. I'm still not. But I'm very efficient. So.
Quick follow-up thing to do with that person who said you're not a real martial artist, why would he say that? What does he give for those reasons?
You know, I'm not going to dive too much into that. What I'm going to tell you is that I'll tell you something pretty straightforward. How many of you guys are online on social media or somewhere out there? Mm-hmm. How many of you
have made it a point to get on and, true or not, run off at the mouth about somebody else online? Maybe one. Okay. How good did you feel about it afterwards?
Not good.
Yeah. So, you know, be it online or be it here from cameras or folks, I'm not going to do that. What I'll say is you got to have a little more class sometimes. And whether you like somebody, whether you believe in what they do, whether you think it's bogus or not, doesn't mean you got to pop off at the mouth and be a punk. So have a little more respect and class for yourself.
Being the Red Ranger for the first so many seasons, I can't remember. What was it like coming back for like the Black and Gold Zero Ranger, and then like coming back to that Forever Red episode?
Well, for Forever Red, I was already in the DC area. I was working in, and I was bartending, paying my way through school, and I was working as an EMT basic. So I wasn't a medic yet, but I was on my way. So I can't remember if it was a phone call or an email. I said, hey, we're going to do this. Would you like to come back and be in an episode with the other Red Rangers? Yeah. Well, that's cool. How many has there been? Three? Wow. They're like, 11. But only 10 are going to be there. 10? Oh, my gosh. Well, it would be great to see the guys. Anyway, I got back, and I had a great time. I think I spent maybe 2 days on set. You know, it's a big extended episode, but if well organized, it doesn't take long to shoot. So I got to meet a lot of the other Red Rangers. A couple of them are, you were the first. Did you sign this? Wow, I can't believe that just happened. You know, so you guys are awesome, you know, because they all were totally different in how they upheld the Red Ranger and what they brought to it in each of their own aspects. And I thought that was great. So I always appreciate seeing people do something already done and do it in a new and cool sort of way. So that was really cool. The Gold Ranger, I got a call from Shuki, the heavy Israeli accent. I'm going to butcher it really bad right now. But he calls me up. Austin! Shuki, what's going on? How are you? I'm good, man. What's up? Because I can feel something's coming. He says, I think maybe you should come meet with us, let's talk, let's maybe, how would you feel maybe about TV series, you should come meet with me. So, okay. So I come up to a set where Blake Foster, who became the Blue Ranger, was about to, I don't think he knew he was going to be the Blue Ranger yet, was filming some movie about Buck. And I'm sitting there on set next to Shuki and watching Blake, and he's this cute little kid, this cute guy. And he's like, so maybe you come back as Gold Ranger, maybe 17 episodes, you know, Sixth Ranger, get mantle, pyramid, you fight, good times. And probably wasn't exactly the words, but it was along those lines. Well, let's talk about a paycheck. Because if we're not going to talk about that, there's no need to talk about the rest. And in the end, they agreed to a minus paycheck. I can deal with it. And he says, what about maybe second movie? Second movie. What's the premise? And he tells me, Red Ranger. He's like, you'd be Red Ranger, you could do this, you could do that, it'd be cool. He's like, who's the Red Ranger now? I had to ask. And it was Tommy at the time. And I thought, okay, well, that's cool. He's a natural choice. You know, when I left, he's a good choice for a leader. I don't need to unseat him to come back. I said, what about making a movie? And he says, and I can see the wheels start turning. Jason, evil? You know, because I was about the most wholesome character in the show. I don't think he could even fathom the idea. And he's like, you're Jason. Yes. I was there when I was me, I know. So he said, what if, you know, you bring me in, I'm not a ranger, and, you know, I carry a supporting role, and somehow I get turned evil, I fight the rangers, and then, you know, at the end, we get the big happy, everybody loves everybody story. He's like, what do you think? And about 3 seconds later, he's like, I like this idea. Because he was extremely creative mind. And so we made some phone calls, and next thing I know, I'm being dipped in a volcano. I have red glowing eyes. I beat the snot out of three Power Rangers in about 3 seconds. End up with one over a fire pit, and then, you know, I guess evil overcomes me, and I get dumped in the fire pit. And, you know, I remember when Frank and I, we were choreographing a fight, because we're martial artists, and we have this whole genre of talent that we wanted to use that, well, we're on Power Rangers. So me grabbing him with chains, because my hands were chained. I was like, yeah, what about at this point, you know, I get you in a lock, turn you over, I'll flip you over my head using the chains by the neck. And the director's like, no. Too violent, you know. So we went through about 30 other options. Too violent. And we settled on what we got. It was just, I was like, okay, well, my character is evil. He's just going to butcher you real quick. So punch a couple times, kick you, get you up over there, and we'll call it a day. So, and we both wanted to do more, but that was not so evil that you couldn't put it on the show.
Okay, we got about 5 more minutes, so we're going to kind of do a lightning round on this. Get through, see if we, how quickly we can get through the questions.
All right.
Several of the Red Rangers now have been based off of your characters. So far, the only true Red Ranger that's based off of you is Troy from Power Rangers Megaforce. Doesn't he kind of remind you of yourself when you were that age?
I have no idea who Troy is.
Well, he's a lot based off of your character. He was a great martial artist, deeply cared for his team, and well, a lot of his characteristics are based off of you.
Well, I guess that's one heck of a compliment. That's pretty cool having me, Troy.
I have a simple question this time. How did you feel about the original Power Rangers movie, the very first one?
Well, I was originally contracted to do it, and we walked off the series maybe a month before they started shooting. So I had seen a script, which very quickly got rewritten, and I thought it was going to be pretty cool. I was actually looking forward to doing it. And I don't think I realized what an impact my character Cleveland would have on the show. And I really didn't know until 20 years later. But I thought the first movie was going to be pretty cool. And I guess it didn't do so well at the box office. But I guess for that, I'm glad I'm not in that.
If you could have a Power Rangers crossover with any other show or movie, what would you choose?
It would have to be something probably between a crossover with, it would be the Power Arrow Walking Dead. He's making stuff up over here.
So when you were overseas, did anyone recognize you as being a Red Ranger? And did they like treat you differently, or were they like starstruck? Or
I chose not to talk about it while I was overseas. I felt like I was with men and women that were there, many of them not of their own choice. And I didn't want to pull attention. So I did my very best. I had a pretty thick beard. I rarely ever spoke of it. Sometimes people would ask, about, because you tell one 18-year-old soldier and the entire base country are going to know in about 15 minutes. And there were other times where I'd meet with guys privately and I would tell them, listen, come back and see me before you punch out, before you go home. And then I would sign for them before they'd go home. That way they didn't have too much time to spread all over the country.
Yeah.
Because the last thing I needed was lines of people coming out of my tent. There were occasions on an ambulance, you know, guy's got a broken up arm, put him in a splint, give him some IV drugs, you know, and he's miserable. And then the drugs hit, and he's like, I kind of look. were you? Yeah. Yeah, it was, there were a few occasions, but for the most people, for the most part, you know, when people were hurt, the last thing they were thinking about was television. But there was definitely some double and triple takes, and some Chow Hall events, we'd walk into DFAC, and I remember as a full bird colonel who had just come over, and I guess his boys were big into the show. And he was running off getting really excited, and like, holy, my God, is he the Red Ranger? Full bird colonel. Yeah, because you don't tell him no. Next thing I know, there's a lunch line on my table. See ya. We're all in BDUs with rifles hanging on them, so. It was good times.
Awesome.
All right, I think that's all the time we have for, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you for listening to the Neverland Podcast.
We invite you back next week for more fun and adventure.
Until then, remember to keep a pixie in your pocket.
It's that young at heart, positive attitude that you can share with others.
And remember to visit our website at neverlandpodcast.com.
There you can find links to our news page, our shop,
our contact page, where you can easily send an email to podcast@neverlandpodcast.com.
You can also find our Neverlanders page, where you can find out how to become an official Lost Boy or Pixie, because girls are too clever to get lost.
Become a real Neverlander.
Please feel free to leave us a voicemail at 816-226-6492.
And be sure to follow us on Twitter at Neverland PCast.
And like our Neverland Podcast fan page on Facebook.
We also have a group on Facebook for you to join.
We also appreciate your support to keep the Neverland Podcast up and running.
Visit patreon.com/neverlandpodcast to donate to keeping the pixie dust alive.
Copyright content featured on the Neverland Podcast is copyright of their respective creators and used under fair use license.
All original content is copyright of Blue Band Productions, and a very special thanks to Yehaa Bob Jackson at yehaabob.com for our new ending music.
God bless!
Yeah! Hello everybody, this is Yehaa Bob Jackson. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, it's true. Neverland.